Good day, everyone. On behalf of ICTF, welcome to this online educational program titled IFRS 9 and US GAAP Implications for Your Business. We are very pleased to welcome all of you, and thank you for choosing ICTF as your educational and professional development association. My name is Beth, and I will be the moderator for today's webcast. Please note that today's webcast is being recorded and all participant lines will be muted during this call. If you need technical assistance at any time, please email us at info@ictfworld.org. The PowerPoint presentation was emailed to all participants earlier today in case you need it for future reference. Today's session will last 60 minutes and includes a question and answer period at the end. However, please do not hesitate to ask questions throughout the presentation using the chat text box at the right-hand side of your screen. Now it is my pleasure to welcome our speaker, Michiel van Hee. With more than 10 years of experience within different credit management positions, Michiel has been involved in development of credit risk solutions for global companies within Atradius for the last 3 years. In the role of Senior Business Development Manager, Michiel has been heading up talks with the Big Four auditors on what IFRS 9 and the US GAAP would mean for non-financial corporates and how the new principle-based impairment rules should be interpreted. Next to that, a number of big global companies were interviewed, and recently a survey was held. During this webinar, we will be touching on the outcomes of the meetings with the Big Four, conclusions of the global interviews, and results of the survey. Also, at the end of this webinar, we will draw a winner from the survey participants for the iPad that was graciously donated by Atradius. Michiel, welcome to the program. Let's get started.
Good afternoon and good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining the webinar, and thank you, Beth, for the introduction. I would like to start off by quickly going through the webinar for today. As mentioned by Beth, I've been interested in IFRS for quite a while, talked to the Big Four, interviewed a number of multinational billion-dollar companies in regards to implementing IFRS 9. But not only IFRS 9 will be touching base on today, also US GAAP. And I'll go into that a little later into more detail. Just to start off, I'd like to build up, just give you a quick overview of what we'll be talking about during the webinar. So a quick recap on why IFRS 9 and US GAAP is being implemented, the main changes, the key elements around that, examples of how a provisioning matrix could or would look like for you as a company, the outcome of a couple of customer interviews and best practices around that, and obviously our survey results, that the survey we held in the past few weeks. Incorporated into the slides, I will give you some views on how the Big Four auditors have looked at and are viewing IFRS 9 implementation and their views going forward. Interestingly enough, and that, to start off with that, is that just reaching back to the past, is that a lot of annual accounts that were published mentioned that IFRS 9 would not have a big implication on their results. And that's interesting, and I'm just mentioning that up front because we'll touch base on that a little later and the implications of mentioning something like that. So just to start off, the agenda for today, IFRS 9 in a nutshell, provisioning matrix and best practices as mentioned, the survey results, and the Q&A. And please, if you have any questions, you could send them through the chat or remarks, and I'll try and incorporate that into the WebEx that we have a little bit of a dynamic WebEx today. To start off with, IFRS 9 in a nutshell and the principles of the IFRS 9. The IFRS 9 standards were created as a reaction of the financial crisis, as you might remember, and it is to increase accuracy and transparency on how credit risk is managed by businesses. So IFRS 9 covers three main areas: classification and measurements, impairments, and hedging accountants. And our focus today is on the impairment of trade receivables, which introduces the expected credit loss model. And this model, this replaces the International Accounting Standards 39, to be precise, a standard and incurred losses principle, which was criticized for because it recognized losses too late. An example about for that is an incurred loss model would work based on aging. A lot of companies work based on aging of their debt receivables. So the older the debt becomes, the more write-off, more impairment is done on the risk. But you don't really look at the quality of the buyers, and that's one of the main changes. So we'll be touching on the forward-looking aspect, and we'll come back to that later. So that's the first part of this slide. Then going into all buyers need to be considered and not just the problematic ones. So credit losses have to be recognized for all receivables, even if the loss expectation is very low. There's no need for an objective evidence of the incurred loss. And that's a very important one to mention. Why? Is because you, at a very early stage, you're going to be looking at the quality of your buyer, and you have to recognize that that's a risk that's hitting your books straight away. So that could even be earlier than the moment the invoice is raised, and that's what we've seen with companies also struggling with a little bit. When do I need to consider the risk on my buyer? Do I do that before or after, and after the invoice is raised? When am I on risk, so to say? And more information and disclosure will be needed as the risk provisions will be based on credit information and less on your expertise judgment. And the rationale behind that is, and that's what we've been talking with auditors about, is there's a higher disclosure requirements that are needed. You need to have processes in place. You have to be able to show the auditor what you're doing and how that process is being set up. And for that, you will need more than just that system where you look at the debt aging of the buyer, but you also have to have information in place on the credit side. You'll have to have a model in place, and we're going to touch base on that a little later. But before we go into that, this was IFRS 9. A lot of information on IFRS 9 can be seen as the same as the US GAAP. And US GAAP is going to be introduced in around 2020, 2021. I'm not going to make many differences during the webinar on the differences between IFRS 9 and the US GAAP, but setting up this webinar, I've been looking at the same aspects to the two. So, and I think that's a very important one, because both the impairment model in the International Finance Reporting Standards, so that's IFRS 9, and the US GAAP will be based on an expected credit loss. So that's important to mention, as well as it is principle based. And we'll get into this a little later. Next to that, both standards require forward-looking elements. So now we'll just mention something very specific around this. This is what auditors mention about it, that the US GAAP favors a single, more likely view of expected macroeconomic conditions over a reasonable and supportable period, after which expected credit losses must revert to historical levels, and IFRS 9 explicitly requires an unbiased and probability-weighted view of expected credit losses considered a range of possible outcomes. So IFRS is a little more prudent, while the US GAAP setup leaves more to interpretation. And that's, I think, the most important part. In regards to the two, once again, both expected credit loss systems, both principle-based, and that's important to know upfront, where, again, we will touch base on this later. Principle-based, I mean, let me quickly go into that. It more or less says that you have implementation guidelines. And we expect, and so do the auditors, that they will likely change as consensus is built and clearer guidelines are provided. I talked to the auditors last year, and no one really knew how this would be specifically implemented. Different auditors had different views to the implementation of IFRS 9 and the impairment model. And that's interesting. So we do expect, through time, more clearer guidance will be provided, given the evolutionary nature of these standards. We will see more clearer view on this. And that's interesting to see what also came out of the survey is that certainly for the US GAAP, there's not really a very clear view on how implementation has to be done, and which I totally understand because of this, because of the fact that it's a principal standard. Going through to the potential impairment on business, absolutely important is the early recognition of impairment losses on receivables. Which means that entities will have to start providing for possible future credit losses in a very first reporting period. As mentioned a little while ago, you'll have to think of when do I need to make that impairment, when do I need to look at that risk hitting the books, and what are the challenges around that, when is the sale done, and when is the invoice raised. Also, more income statement volatility. And that's coming from the fact that more assets will have to be measured at fair value within changes in fair value recognition in profit and loss as they arise. And you'll have to update this every time, every reporting period, and any changes that have to be made there. So to be clear on that, on the moment there's a change, it will have to hit the books, and there are significant new disclosure requirements which we've already mentioned a little bit on. Going on to the provisioning matrix, and we're going to go into practical. A practical overview, but this is just to give you guys some kind of framework into a little background on how this has been set up, what the rationale is behind it, what the basis principles are. But we do see that it's likely that most financial institutions will apply a simplified approach, and that's what we've also seen out of the interview outcomes and what I'm seeing right now in the market. As this will allow companies, so that principle, so the simplified approach will allow companies to leverage their existing provisions practices. So I talked about the annual accounts receive or the annual accounts, and that no one had really mentioned that IFRS would have a big implication on their impairments. They companies, what we see so far, are also looking into how can we implement the provisioning matrix as simple as possible, and again also make sure that the impairments are not very different to what they have been in the past. So you can tweak the model the principle-based model. And that's an important thing to keep in mind, because we are living on average in a global economy that's going up. But you could ask yourself, what happens with my trade receivables and my impairments when we have an economic downturn? It's something to keep in mind. The implication of quoted statements is that provisioning rates for past due receivables will have to be adjusted, and a separate provisioning matrix will have to be prepared for every relevant buyer grouping. And that's an important one to mention as well, is that obviously it's very important to make sure you have enough data. You have to create data segments. And let me go into showing you how that would work. So the provisioning matrix and the best practices. So just before we go into how you would calculate it, how you could possibly calculate your provisioning matrix, as mentioned, it's a principle-based model, but there are a number of key elements that need to be taken into account. So you have to calculate your expected credit loss by looking at a rating, a POD rating, and it has to be forward-looking. You have to look at your loss given default and exposure at default in the combination. But provisioning rates may be based on groupings or variation segments as geographical regions, product types, customer ratings, collateral. So those are all important things that can be used in this overview. Very important is calculating this expected credit loss is the probability of default information. How do I get that information? Where do I get that information from? Is it stable or not? Is it forward-looking? Does it have a forward-looking element to it? The loss given default, certainly with global customers, we see that global customers have a lot of own historical data and use that as a basis. They also have to create a forward-looking element to it, but a lot of companies are able to make sure that that information is sound enough. Most companies are struggling with finding a good, solid, stable data source for the probability of default information. Because just looking at your buyers and getting the latest auditing accounts from that buyer in, for example, Ukraine or Turkey, yeah, that might be not giving you the full scope, although that might be something that the auditor would feel comfortable enough with. You will need to make sure that on a regular basis you have updated information. And it also takes into account that macroeconomic development in that country. It's interesting to see, and that there's a little text on the bottom of the slide, that bad debt provisions could increase significantly up to 25%. And the interesting thing is that out of the survey, 10% was estimated. And we'll go into that a little later, but it does show that there are differences around that, and different companies look at their expected bad debt provisions to develop in a different manner. Going to the provisioning matrix. So historically, companies would look at their outstandings, receivables, and would impair based on an incurred loss model. So what they would do is look at their overdue receivables after due date, and it didn't even matter what the due date was of the buyer. So if it was 60-day payment term, 90-day payment term, 180 or 270, they would look after the moment of past due, and then start making impairments based on that. So you see that in the example, past due 0 to 90 days, you see that the development of, or the provisioning rate is 10%. So provision is made for 8 in this case. It's an example. Past due 90 to 180 days is 20, and past due more than 180 days is 12. So provision rate is made of 60% there. So that's based on an incurred loss model. So as of 2018 for IFRS 9, but going forward in the US GAAP, same thing applies because we all have there, again, the expected credit loss model. You have to present it straight away when it hits the books. And I've mentioned it a couple of times, but I'm mentioning it explicitly because it's so important to know is that straight away, even though that the amounts are undue, you already have to start provisioning. And that could well be that you have to start provisioning even before the invoice is raised. Well, that's something you could think of as a company, how you would go about implementing that. What we see for multinationals at the moment, they start making provisions straight away from the moment it's undue. So the moment the invoice is raised, a provision rate is made. And in this case, you see that between the incurred loss model and the expected credit loss model, we see a difference of a provision of 7. So, and where does the 7 come from? It's because amounts undue, we see a 2% provisioning made, which is 7, and then that makes the difference because past due to 0 to 90, 190 to 180, and above 180 days, that stayed the same. It's an important one to mention that this is still just the basis because we're going into how do you calculate that provisioning rate because you have to show the auditors what you're doing and that it's sound, it's stable, it's feasible. Because if that is not the case and you don't have a stable set of rules, you could see that in an economic downturn, these numbers will start changing significantly and you'll have to start making more provisions, which will hit the P&L straight away on every moment you have to report, and which is obviously something a CFO will not be happy with. And it's such an important thing to mention that credit managers have such an important role to play here. And interestingly enough, we'll touch base on that and through the survey as well, that you see that a lot of companies have not really involved the credit managers or on the trade receivable side to think about, okay, what would this mean for us? A question was raised in regards to how this would work for all of balance receivables purchasing programs. Well, can be clear on that. If it's on a non-recourse basis, it falls off your balance sheet. So that's very easy to mention. If it's on a recourse basis, it stays on your balance sheet, and it's just as important for you to be making provisioning rates on the trade receivables. So on that point, do we expect then maybe in the future to see more off-balance receivable purchasing programs? Well, that could be. Maybe not an economic high, but maybe in a downturn it could well be that that would happen. And from my experience, I currently see that a lot of key KPIs are being met, and it is very important to mention that based on those KPIs, companies will maybe even start doing more on an off-balancing receivables purchasing program there. Okay, going through to the next slide, we also see, so I've just shown you the views on the different, I've shown you the differences between the incurred losses and the expected credit loss. So how do you calculate it then? I showed you the calculations earlier, and this is an example of how you could calculate it. This is good crediting ratings in Western Europe, and the calculation is without credit insurance or collection services, so it's based on their own data. I'm just looking at the questions we are receiving in, so to see if I can incorporate them right now. And I think we'll touch base on that a little later. So the potential impact in this case, we see, and the reason why we're going to show you this is also you can use mitigating tools to lower the POD rates and the LGD rates. But in this case, you see nothing is used here. The only source is business information because you need that, those PODs. And so we see that on the trade receivables part, the POD is 0.8 and the LGD is 50%. So the calculated expected credit loss rate is 0.4 on the 350 that's outstanding, which will give you a expected credit loss provision of 1.4. And then going down, you see that past due, the POD increases, and the LGD stays the same. Interestingly enough, obviously these POD rates are based on the POD rates of that company at that specific time in the economic development or the macroeconomic outlook at that moment in time. So you could see that if the economic forecast changes, that then the POD rate will change as well, which is interesting and important to keep in mind. Therefore, it's very important to have a very stable POD development because it will not, which takes into those macroeconomic developments, because it will not be as volatile. And certainly, if you have not too many different providers worldwide, it will help you. Just a question that that was raised. What the question is that when do you know if you have a company that is subject to CECL, so that's the US GAAP, or IFRS 9 for each geography? Yeah, that's information that we can share afterwards. But certainly in Europe, if a company is locally situated and is a multinational, they will use IFRS 9 standards, and that goes for companies in Russia, Canada as well, outside of the US. But there are information where you could really get that out of the. There are some overviews you could easily find out on that. Going into the example, so we just showed you example where we worked on a POD, where the POD information was there and the LGD information was there. I just want to show you an example where, if you would use credit insurance, how that would change the POD rates and the LGD rates. Rationale behind it being that if you insure to a third party, just as you, if you off balance on a non-recourse, you change the scope. And in this case, if you insure, you're not looking at the risk of the buyer anymore, but you're looking at the risk of the credit insurer. And based on the rate of the credit insurer, you can see what the POD is. And in this case, we have taken an example that the POD rate would be 0.04%. That's the default rate of the credit insurer. And the LGD rate is lower as well because you're using a collection agency. So that lowers your loss given default as well. However, there's always skin in the game. So where you see on the A overview, we have a POD of 0.04%. You see on the B overview that the POD rate is 0.8 and then increases over time. That's an interesting thing to see, and we expect going forward that companies will incorporate this into their credit management and take into account what the alternatives would be there to look at how can we make sure that impairments made now and in the future are stable so that CFOs are able to make sure that the probable outcome of what the business is, how the business is performing, is not too much hit by impairments made on the debt receivables. And that's something we expect we'll see more in the future. So what did we see with customer interviews? And this is an interesting one to mention, is we saw different things when interviewing customers. We looked at big multinationals, three of them. And I think the first thing to mention is the balance sheet of the company. If you work for a manufacturing business, that is making stuff, it's going to be, they're going to have a totally different balance sheet than if a company would be a trader, because a trader will have a very big part of their balance sheet will be the trade receivables part, could be up to a quarter maybe even of the total balance sheet. Because traders might need to also give longer payment terms. Manufacturing companies will have much more on the balance sheet. And that's an interesting one to keep in mind, because if impairments are made and they hit the balance sheet and the impairment is significant, that's going to change the rules and maybe even change the way auditors are looking and banks look at the company. What we saw with the companies we interviewed, they all had a very good view of their write-offs. They knew what they were writing off. They knew where the write-offs were coming from. So they had a lot of historical data in regards to their loss given default. So on the loss given default side, they said, yeah, we don't see much added value for a third party to step in. We don't see much added value of getting that information in. We also looked at the buildup of the portfolio, because obviously you could have an average low write-off, but then again, it would be interesting to see how the development how that stands into equation of small, very large buyers and small buyers, so high risk or high exposures on specific buyers. And we saw that a lot of companies have a lot of information on their high exposures, logically, but on their lower exposures, there's a lot of general information, and they're struggling with finding good probability of default information there. And that's also something where we see that a lot of companies are being challenged to get their information there. Next to that, what we saw was that how were they setting up their provisioning matrix? So how were they implementing IFRS 9? And a lot of companies were still struggling, because this was done late last year, we're still struggling with really finding a way of setting up their provisioning matrix. But what they more or less generally all did was set it up based on their historical system, so their incurred losses principle, and then create an element as shown in the examples I showed you earlier, and added provisioning per aging bucket starting from undue invoices. So that's the big difference, and having more quality on their buyers. So looking rather at the just based on the loss history, they also had to bring a qualitative element to it and also look at the forward-looking element. And that's the big difference between what we've seen, how we historically companies look at this, and what they have had to implement over the last few months. Because obviously IFRS 9 was implemented from the 1st of January 2018, and I think a lot of companies are only now really digging into this and making sure they're crossing all the T's and hitting all the I's. Even banks, you see that banks had to implement this from the 1st of January, and well, more or less got it up and done by, were done somewhere in January. So people are still working on this a lot. Looking into what did companies still search for? And certainly big companies are searching for, and I've mentioned this a couple of times, POD information, country information, sector information across the globe, and they are struggling finding the right information they need to make sure that that forward-looking POD, that forward-looking POD information is there as well. Okay, so just to recap a little bit so far, I talked a little bit about the background to IFRS 9 and US GAAP, why it was set up. Talked a little bit about setting up and the provisioning matrix. Gave a few examples of how we would set that up, and these customer interviews. And now I'd like to go through to the survey results, because they show an interesting overview of how credit management teams are involved. And I think we've shown that credit management teams should be involved, fully involved, in setting up a expected credit loss model, the provisioning model, because it's so important to know something about the quality of your buyers. And there's no better place than the credit management team, who's been doing this for years on average already, to get involved here and play a part and become even more important within the company as a source, not only making sure that the buyer debt portfolio is managed well, but you're also getting a finance-driven part here as well. So what we see is that at least almost 80% is informed. A few are not informed, and there were some specifics where it was mentioned we reviewed the new methodology for bad debts provisions, and now we're getting started to use it. Informed and involved, but actual calculation, posting, and reporting is done centrally. So that's good. Yeah, I believe there's a role for credit management teams to play here, and we've also heard that from auditing companies, so the Big Four, where a lot of reporting will also be done on this, checking out, okay, what are you doing? How's your provisioning matrix set up? Are you in control? What are your controls there, and how do you follow up on this? Logically, on the US GAAP side, and I was even surprised that already 30% is involved and 10% is informed, but is not part of the implementation process, I would say, yeah, try get a place at the table. Obviously, you don't need to talk about leasing, hedging, and all the other stuff that has to do with IFRS 9, but it is good to be part of the implementation side on the modeling side and the provisioning side, and not only on the rollout. Another question we raised was, which area of IFRS 9, in your view, will have an impact on the financial statement on practice most? And most said clarification and measurement, which we've touched on as well, but also a significant part of the people we had the survey with mentioned impairment. And impairment is interesting, and it's mentioned a couple of times. And It is some to some. Could be a major part of the company's balance sheet. And if a company has an outstanding of say 500 million, and an impairment has to be made, an additional impairment has to be made of say only 5%, then that is another 25 million that has to be provisioned for. And companies don't like that, and which I can totally imagine, because it's money you can't spend or can't use for development, growth, and so forth. 9% mentioned hedging, and yeah, it is an important part and an important role, I can imagine, within the company's statements as well. The question, to what extent do you believe that IFRS 9 US GAAP impairment requirements will impact your daily work? 30% luckily said hardly, which I'm happy for, because that means there's not much work coming to them. 63% mentioned to some extent, and to some extent, yeah, obviously there are different questions you can mention. That there, again, what is to some extent, how much extra work is coming to you, and can you put in specific tools to make sure that the workload doesn't become significantly bigger in the future. So make sure that you have set up your matrix in such a way that it is stable, it is forward-looking, and it can have some fluctuation in the future. On the US GAAP side, significantly, well, I can imagine that 30% says significantly, because you are getting ready to implement this to some extent, and 30% hardly. Well, I think that the difference is between people that are still need to process it to implement it, and the people that are already working on this. And it's interesting for the US GAAP people to look at IFRS 9, because I expect that that will be your future view on things. I am getting a couple of questions in, but I'll keep them for right at the end, because then we can go back to a number of slides people would like to talk about. Do you benefit from using external providers? Another question we raised, in order to comply with IFRS 9 and US GAAP's information requirements. Well, a significant number of people mentioned no. Which I must say could mean two things. They are already using the external providers, so don't see an additional benefit to using them already, or are, well, getting all that information in through their own data sources, external information, and that would be something I would question, or at least I would like to challenge, is to make sure that, keep in mind that if you're doing all the work yourself within and getting that data in, yeah, it might be fine right now, but also keep in mind, how does my model work towards the future and in economic more unstable moments. Not criticizing it, by the way, because I think it's fine if you can get your information in as well by yourself. So 8% on the IFRS side acquires probability of default information, 21% utilizes through credit insurance, and 25% uses a collection and recovery services. So I would say there's more or less a 50-50 split between people saying using external information or external providers, I don't really benefit from that, towards parties using external parties. So that's interesting to see, and would be good to see how the developments go forward. On the US GAAP side, we see that 33% say normal, and 33% use credit insurance to utilize to make sure that they get their information, your US IFRS 9 US GAAP information in. 11% use the probability of default information, and 11% use collection services. And 11% mention others with like they're not yet using this. This was the general part of it. So do you benefit from using external providers in order to comply with new information requirements? Again, 55% say they don't really benefit from external providers. Interesting. You see that 27% again use credit insurance and 9% acquire probability of default information. So most do it on their own. And I must say was a very interesting outcome to see, as I would have expected more parties to use external data sources. Do you believe that bad debt reserves in your company balance sheet will increase as a result of the new IFRS 9 impairments and the CECL rules? 36% say there will be no increase, and 36% say there will be a minor increase up to 10%, and 27% say something different. They don't know, they're not sure. These are the main things that came back, unknown, as they were not yet involved. But it was interesting to see that they mentioned that it's time for us to, in credit, to invite ourselves to the implementation team, and I full heartedly say go for it. So it is different to, and I mentioned this at the beginning of the, I had a nice comment on the lower level of the slide was mentioning that 25%, up to 25% was expected of increases to the bad debt reserves. And here we see that there's a much lower expectation. So that's positive news, I would say. You could ask yourself, why is that, based on what rationale, and what is the reasoning behind it? Is it because the model has been tweaked in such a way that that the same outcome has come out of it or not? And that's an interesting one, which I forgot to mention for the pharmaceutical company, and I mentioned this earlier as well, is that based on the incurred losses, you would look at your past due. But say you have a lot of public buyers with long payment terms, like tender business, 360 days, you will definitely see bigger impairments have to be made, because you have to start making impairments right from the start, even though the invoice is not due yet. And what you see is that a lot of companies have been tweaking based on what kind of buyer is it, which sector, is it a public buyer or not. So tweaks have been made around that to get more and more view on and making sure that the impairments were stable or not, didn't differ too much from the historical views there. So I think that's it. So if I'll go through the, before we go into the Q&A, I'll try and quickly jump into the chats. So someone says that besides the provisional matrix, do you also still need to register all account balances in full if you already know the POD is going to be high, independent of the matrix? It's a good question. I'm not an auditor, so I would say I would ask your auditor what they would give back to you. But I would expect that this is an add-on to what you already do. So you need to make sure that the matrix is filled with information you get from yourself or an external party, that it's valid, that it's structured, that there's a rationale behind it. You will have to know what you're doing, and the risk on the buyer obviously stays the same. So from your credit management side, you'll want to know certainly if the PD is going to be high, you might want to know more about that specific buyer. So I would definitely try and get more insights into the buyer, and you could even ask yourself the question, is this buyer still someone I would like to work with, and is this also going to be a credit worthy partner in the party in the future? But that's all about that POD information. Where is it coming from? What's the rationale behind it? To go into, I don't want to talk too much about Atradius today, but to give you an view on how a credit insurance party would do it, is obviously they look at all the information they get in, and based on that, a POD rating is structured, and we have made sure that that POD rating is always for all, also forward-looking. So, and that data is globally the same structures, the same models in place. And for countries where there's very little information, you might go to a country POD rather than a individual POD or a sector POD. Another question was raised in regards to if I could give some in additional information on the LGDs with or without credit insurance and a collection agency. So I'll just quickly pop back to slide 9 and slide 10. In this case, we mentioned that in this example, this was, as you could read, a good credit rating West Europe, the expected credit loss calculation without credit insurance and collection services. So this is based on what is going to be your historical data without using any third party to collect that money. If you use credit insurance, and you could not use a credit insurer or just a credit, a collection service provider, collection agency, then the LGD will be looked at based on what that collection agency historically has done in that market. So take, for instance, Atradius Collections has a lot of historical data because they've done a lot of work in specific markets. So they will have a more comprehensive overview of what the average loss given default in that market could be. And if you historically only had a few buyers in a market and one of those buyers unfortunately went insolvent and you were not able to recover too much, you could, based on your own historical loss given default information, that loss given default information will be much higher than an average which Atradius will have based on that same sector with the same buyers, but then the portfolio is bigger and give you a bigger view on that. And I hope this gives a bit more clarity, and otherwise, please send me another note or another chat. Another question that was raised is, how can you test if your proposed provision matrix is adequate? How can auditors help us here? Well, definitely on the provisioning matrix setup side, I would definitely use an auditor there, because they are the specialists here. Third parties can help you with the information side, and we also see in the market partners coming up with a whole model. However, please look at it as if it's a black box. I can imagine that you would like to know what's happening in that provisioning matrix. What's going in? How does the matrix work? And what is coming out? So if you test your proposed provisional matrix, it would be great if you really understand what's happening in that matrix. And that's why we as Atradius have chosen to just provide you with all the data, but not help you set up that provisional matrix, because we believe that someone like an auditor or another third party can help you set that up best. But with the right data, you'll definitely see if the model is adequate and your auditor can help you there. Prepaid accounts is not included in the provisional matrix. Another question that was raised, prepaid accounts do not come up in your balance sheet, and you can always ask yourself, what is a prepaid account? Is it a full account? Is it partial? Prepayment on a invoice? But if it's a true prepayment, 100% pre-invoiced and paid before going on risk, it will not appear on your provisional matrix. Are footnote disclosures required for different macroeconomic circumstances? Very good question. I would raise it to your auditor because I don't want to step in here. I can definitely imagine that you have to explain where your macroeconomic information is coming from, and you have to tell the auditor why you're using that data and if that data is reliable. Why the data is reliable towards the future, and how you can say that it's stable. You could think of a third party that's delivering information. And please, I'm not talking about the company I work for, but there are a lot of companies out there that you can get that macro economic information from. So and a very interesting other question, expansion versus recession versus depression. Well, first of all, I don't hope we will see a depression any time in the future. But yes, it's a good question, and you could get tools in place to mitigate those risks. On the other hand, you could also think that getting a good and decent and adequate, as mentioned earlier, provisioning setup will also stabilize developments going up and down, because POD information is also, there's a macroeconomic development in there. So obviously you're not looking at an incurred, the loss has happened, so now I provision for it, you're provisioning up front, and you obviously will see that provisions will go up with a recession and a depression, but hopefully your system works in such a way that you see developments and you can react to them. You can be proactive instead of reactive. Would Altman Z score be helpful to establish POD or data? I have to skip this one because I'd like to give an answer on it, but I'm not into it as much as I would hope to be able to answer that question. So I would refer it. I can look it up and get back to this person in after the webinar. Are documentary payment accounts included in the provisioning matrix, and will the LGD then also linked to the data provisioning by our banks? Good question. Documentary payments accounts included, that depends on what kind of documentary payments they are, but if you're talking about ILCs and depending on the setup, yes, they will be included as long as you're on risk. And the LGD will be lower because it is linked to the data provided by your bank. So that is correct, and you're mitigating if you have a documentary payment. But again, you have all kinds of wonderful colors there between something that is rock solid and something that is very, very flexible. So I think that's an important one to keep in mind. What is the provisioning matrix going to do based on your documentary payments? It depends what kind of documentary payment you have in place, and that will reflect in the LGD as well. I think there's one other question before giving, and I see I only have 1 minute left. is mandatory to under US or IFRS 9 or US GAAP that IFRS be adopted? If so, when is adoption deadline? So IFRS 9 has been implemented from the 1st of January 2018. The US GAAP goes in from around expected 2020-2021. Yeah, so IFRS 9 is a different standard to the US GAAP, but there's a lot of similarities, as mentioned, starting this this WebEx. I think that's all from my side. So I'd like to give the floor back to Beth.
Okay. If there's any additional questions, again, just simply type your question in the text chat box area on the right-hand side of your screen and hit send. We'll leave this open for just a couple minutes to see if we have any additional questions.
Okay, I think from my side, if there are no other questions, I'd like to thank you for your interest today. If you have any further questions or specifics, things I did not answer to in as much depth as you would have liked to, then please drop me a note or an email, and I'm happy to look at that one-on-one. And I think, Beth, we still have one more thing to do.
And yes, we do. We have randomly drawn the winner of the iPad, and the winner is Patrick Botts. And Patrick, we will be in contact with you for further details. I want to thank everyone for your participation, and thank you, Michiel. If you would like more information on ICTF's upcoming events, including our symposiums, we have one coming up in April 22nd through the 24th in Chicago. We have one in May 13th through the 15th in Budapest. If you want any information on those, please visit our website at www.ictfworld.org. Thank you. The webinar has ended. You may now disconnect.